You want to come in here for just a minute? Thank you. We're having some troubles in Sector 4. Some of the men and also some of the women are not following proper procedure. I think what it's time for is... No, we don't need any of those right now. It's a private meeting. Thank you. Goodbye.
We've already talked about Sector 4.
We're going to have to call in a consultant, and we're going to have to crack down.
All right, sir. I'll.
Yeah, I know. I know we tried to be lenient. I know we tried to have flexibility. I know we tried...
If you just
to let the men and women in Sector 4 have a little bit of control over their own environment
in
some of the decision-making.
You only give us another chance.
I think it's time we admit to ourselves and we announce officially that it has been a failed policy and we're going to go back to the old control. We've got to tighten this ship. All right, are we in agreement?
Not at all, sir. My reforms are in place.
Because that's what's going to happen, and it's going to happen today. Now, we're expecting the consultant. His name is Mr. Smithson, I believe. He'll be here momentarily. I'm told he's on a chopper as we speak. And he'll be landing momentarily, and we're going to take this right down to Sector 4 in a matter of moments.
Sector 4 could work.
In agreement?
No, we're not.
No, sir.
Well, as I said before, I don't care. What's that? Okay, gentlemen, please. Gentlemen, calm down now. All right, I've just been informed that our consultant will be approximately 1 hour delayed. His chopper is, I don't know, it's caught in some trees or something. I don't know what it is. Point is, he'll be here in about an hour. We've got some time to kill.
We've got to work together on
this. You, turn on the radio.
Yes, sir. What station?
Down on the low end, where the good stuff is.
Yeah, I think the NeoRadio hour is on. Hi, I'm Peter Donald. This is the NeoRadio hour, home of independent writers, musicians, and home tapers, the folk artists of the electronic age. We've got the usual eclectic mix of scenes, stories, and sound sculpture tonight, including a few neo bits from our own studios. Mr. Sunshine and Frank the Courier are not here this evening. They're vacationing together, I believe. That's what I heard, somewhere in the Pacific. Maybe they'll make a tape for us while they're there. That'd be cool. And in conversation tonight, an anonymous contributor from the streets of San Francisco. You'll hear it when it comes. It's the Neo Radio Hour. Independent audio art. Especially for Sector 4. Good luck, fellas.
Do it.
listen. To the time. We used to listen.
We used to listen.
Today.
Today.
We used to listen.
We used to listen.
To the sun.
To the sun.
We used to listen.
Listen.
To the moon.
To the moon.
Listen to the ocean.
Ocean.
We used to listen.
We used to listen to the ocean.
We used to look.
Look.
We used to watch.
Watch.
We used to listen.
Listen.
Watch.
Look.
Watch.
Moon.
Look at the moon.
Look at the ocean.
Look at the sun.
Each other.
Look, 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 look,
look, look, look,
look, look,
look, look, look, look,
look, look, look, look,
look, look,
look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look,
look, look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look, look,
look, look, look,
TV.
Oh, it hurts.
Oh.
The Neo Radio Hour.
Yo, Benny, get your ass over here. Don't you run from me, you Scotch bastard. Get your sorry ass over here. Benny stopped and fished through the pockets of his long green overcoat for a cigarette. He had not remembered to buy a pack for 3 days. Still, he was constantly amazed when his search failed to turn up the smoke. He turned and crossed O'Farrell Street in the middle of the block, causing a taxi to hit its horn, and, as a last resort, its brakes. Hey, Cliff Mickey, you got a smoke? Cliff Mickey looked at him for a moment with his cold, gray eyes, and finally broke into a smile. Sure, Benny. I got a smoke. He pulled a cigarette from his pocket and lit it before handing it to Benny. They locked eyes while Benny hotboxed a cigarette. He had smoked half of it before Cliff Mickey smoked. I got an invite from Big Frankie to a concert that Ant Boy and you are putting on at his place. You gotta tell me what the hell is going on. Benny smoked the rest of his cigarette. He stopped to look at it as it burned into the filter as if he couldn't believe that he'd smoked it. Then looked at Cliff Mickey and asked, "You got another smoke?" Cliff Mickey looked at him, all traces of humor gone from his face, and pulled another from his pocket. Holding it in Benny's face, he said in a voice that sounded like a wolf snarl, "Sure, Benny, I got a couple semi-loads of cigarettes, and I don't pay taxes on them. It's not going to cost me a whole hell of a lot to burn your fingers to the bones and make sure you never play the piano again if you don't start talking." Benny began pacing in a small circle, stopping on a second lap to take the cigarette from Cliff Mickey. On a sixth lap, having smoked half the cigarette, he stopped and locked eyes with Cliff Mickey. "Look, man, I wasn't looking for trouble from Big Frankie, and I'm not looking for trouble from you. All I want to do is get to the Donatello so I can play their baby grand for a while before they toss me out." He stopped speaking and finished the cigarette. Cliff Mickey glared at him and growled, "Look, all I know is that Big Frankie sent me an invite to a performance of some extraordinary piece that you and Ant Boy perform. I want to know what the hell is going on." He paused, took a deep breath, and began again in a measured low voice. "Look, Benny, you're one hell of a great piano player. The little stint I did in Sing Sing taught me that it's better to work things out with people than to leave bodies strewn about like yesterday's newspaper. I'll tell you straight up, you can talk to me or you can talk to a couple of my shield maidens." At the mention of the shield maidens, Benny paled, stopped his pacing, and looked at Cliff Mickey as if he had just realized he was there. "Look, Big Frankie wants to feed me the fish. I agreed to do this gig to keep from wearing cement loafers. I don't know why he's suddenly taking an interest in my musical career, and I don't even want to know what is happening between you two." Cliff Mickey knew Benny well enough to know that he lived in a world that consisted only of chords, keyboards, riffs, and a beautiful stripper that had stolen his heart. He could not imagine how he could possibly be involved in any plot that Big Frankie was hatching. He reached out and grabbed Benny by the lapels, drew him close to his face, and hissed, "If I decide to attend this little performance of yours, I'd better be entertained, because my shield maidens have been getting really bored and have been begging me to send some work their way." Having been released and beginning to get very pissed off at his mistreatment at the hands of both Big Frankie and Cliff Mickey, Benny said in a voice void of any emotion, "Show up and I promise you, it'll be a very interesting evening." He spun and strode away, and Cliff Mickey yelled at his fleeing back, "Yeah, you Scotch bastard, I'll be there. You damn well better entertain me. Oh yeah, Benny, before you show up for the concert, buy a razor."
Good day, my Lord Rosenblum.
And a good day to you, Lord Skillworth. How goes by you this fine day?
I'm afraid I'm feeling a touch of the grip today, my Lord. Perhaps my servant could shake your servant's hand.
Clever fellow, Skillworth. Go, you ninny, and shake hands with my Lord's manservant. Tell me, Skillworth, what do you think of my new outfit? You seem to disapprove, my Lord.
It's the cuffs, my Lord. You should have them flow, let them ripple, so that when His Majesty takes his snuff, 'tis like a swallow's flight.
Sink me, my Lord, you're right. I'll have my tailor hung immediately and get another. A good day to you.
And a good day to you.
When I look into the mirror, deep into my own blue eyes, see hellfire burning, words could not describe. For justice is for rich men and their gifted sons, none for the poor hill folk, the indigent and dumb. So warm yourself by your fire and sing your songs of liberty. And the next man you put to dying, remember there was none for me. When the good Lord shines His light deep into my soul, no more jailhouse days, no digging for company coal. Lord shines His light deep into my soul. No more jailhouse days, no digging for company coal. Well, sir, I say it's strange how a word can twist and turn. There's one thing in my years of waiting I have surely learned. Put me from your sight, you can put me from your mind. When it's time to cross that line, your eyes will not meet mine. Tonight I hope your bed is warm, come the witching hour. You sleep soundly till the dawn, while my life is devoured. Good Lord shines His light deep into my soul. No more jailhouse. What you will, for the customer is forever right, the man who foots the bill. So bury me up in the hills, where the black bears still roam free, with all of God's good creatures standing watch on me. For man no longer holds me chains, for my life will be done when the dawn does break again. When the good Lord shines his light deep into my soul, no more jailhouse days, no digging for company coal. When the good Lord shines his light, no more jailhouse days, no digging for company coal.
You're listening to the Neo Radio Hour, independent audio art.
Not long ago, when I was standing outside in the sunlight, the bright day, when a thought struck me. A thought about the purpose of the porpoise. The purpose of the porpoise is something which many people don't think about on normal, sunny, bright days. Many, many miles from the sea. But the purpose of the porpoise seemed at that moment to be particularly important. As I turned to a passerby and posed the question of the importance of a porpoise, he poorly answered that he didn't really care, and went on his way. And as I watched his feet moving, pounding on the concrete, I thought to myself, what a strange response. What a strange way to address a problem which may at that time seem insignificant, but later that night, when I sat across the table from my wife and she spread the butter so smooth upon the bread, I was struck again with my perplexing puzzle. My dear, I said, in humble expectation of all sorts of enlightenment from this woman who I chose out of the multitude to be my one and only wife. My dear, I said, what is the purpose of the porpoise? She sat back in her chair and her eyes glazed over slightly as she let the butter knife rest upon her porcelain. I was sure she was just about to speak when the phone rang. It was a call from her mother. Her mother normally calls at 8, and it was only 7:45. Something must have been terribly wrong. Perhaps it was my postulation, my puzzlement, my quizzical ways, which had radiated from my wife and had signaled to her mother that there was something dreadfully wrong. But there was nothing dreadfully wrong. I answered the phone and put the question straight to her mother. Mom, as I normally call her Mom, I said, Mom. Mom, I said, as I normally do. What is the purpose? Mom, Mom, what is the purpose? What is the purpose of a porpoise, Mom? Mom. There was silence on the other end of the wire for a very long time. And then I heard it hang up. I told my wife to hang on just a second and held it to my ear as if nothing had gone wrong. And then when the hang-up, the buzzing, that kind of, well, you should hang up your phone now, there's nobody listening to you, that obnoxious sound the telephone company puts out, that thing which rang into my ear so loud and screamed at me, I had to say, your mother will probably call you back later on, dear. She's got something else she's got to do.
Hey, Rocky, watch me pull a rabbit out of this hat.
Sheila casts a spell for 7 days and 7 nights, lighting candles mounted in sectioned grapefruit, murmuring, pulling him in. She gets him. He kills her.
In the Ohlone tribe, twins, like me, were believed to possess malignant powers. That's why they were killed at birth.
He says we were brought together because of God. And I say no, I think it was science. But when he makes love to me, I see God. Is that bad or is that good?
Love magic got hot, left the mystical, and became practical on a very comfortable street where the popular rest on starry days. Badness turned over on itself, ran around the corner in need of a vice to become imprisoned by, and purchased some good shit from a sorcerer who carried the backlash, Bible, and a time card.
In my other life, I'm a powerful wizard. Oh yeah? Well, in this life, you better bring me a shake with those fries, pal.
The universe is neurotic. Line, it stands out. As a point, it sucks. Bad magic is any magic that primarily serves the magician.
We need magic the way a junkie needs 7 layers of clothes. Man, the world's just too damn cold.
The dog 2 backyards away, hell barking at all hours of the day and night. With as many guns as we have in this neighborhood, it's some bad magic he hasn't been shot.
Senior year of college, I signed up for an advanced anthropology class, a seminar on witchcraft. When I went to talk to the professor about admittance to his 400-level class, he looked me up and down, noting the half-dozen necklaces full of amulets and crystals, and sneered, "You do realize that this course is a serious study of witchcraft in other cultures, not a practicum for young witches in training."
Linguistics is the history of torture.
Jop. Blanc. Now that's the name of this guy I saw. This Dutch guy with this unlikely name doing old sound poems by Schwitters and Hugo Ball and Robert Wilson. Newer stuff of his own. It was magical. It was like Danny Kaye doing furious Zen. It was as though the sounds were birds of prey released as a flock into the auditorium. Full gibberish, lip smacking, twitchingly percussive and frenetic stuff at one point in the middle of something like this. Trickle of blood slipped out of his left nostril and seeped to his mouth, as though the incantatory nature of sound could have had real and tangible effects. The whole minute you could feel how truly subversive these guys were back then, these sound poets, when art was dangerous enough to make people riot or pull you into that or out a window. For a second, the auditorium faded, and we were all sitting in the smoky Cabaret Voltaire in Zurich, sipping wormwood, dreaming of revolution.
Former roommate spent way too much time stinking up the shoebox-sized apartment with burning sage after my friends who she hated were overhanging out. With a smoldering handful of twigs, she would traipse through each room muttering something about purifying the sanctified space and getting rid of the bad vibes. Thank God she finally moved up north to go to massage school.
It's the Neo Radio Hour.
My Lord Rosenblum.
Oh, good day, Lord Skillworth.
You look a bit peaked today, my lord.
I've given my servants the day off and have been without my sedan chair.
You what?
I said I gave my servants
the... Sink me, my lord. You give the riffraff a day off and they'll be doing nothing but plotting against you.
Hell's bells, you're probably correct in your assumption, my lord. What are we to do?
Well... let me send out my dragoons and wipe them out. You should be more careful with your servants, Rosenblum. We gentlemen must maintain the status quo.
Thank you, Skillworth. We've probably averted an uprising of sorts, eh, good fellow?
Indeed, we probably have. Now, I am in possession of 4 brawny Scots who would carry you about as if you were on a cloud. You could have them for, let's say, 50 crowns apiece, and that boar's head, which I so much admire above your mantle.
Oh, not the boar's head, my lord. It's been in the family for years.
Well, I'm sure we can come to a suitable arrangement. Good day, my lord.
Oh, and a good day to you.
Philosopher Michel Foucault said, "Madness cannot be found in a wild state. Madness exists only within a society. It does not exist outside the forms of sensibility which isolate it, and the forms of repulsion that exclude or capture it."
My name is Charles. I live on the welfare hotel line. I had a million and one problems in 1982 because in 1979 somebody was using my social security number and working for the E&M Truman Company, and the social security office didn't want to do anything about it. I told them I was in a psychiatric hospital in December 1979 and they kept insisting I was acting. And I sent recordings to Ronald Reagan by 1984, but I was big brother because in 83 I had discovered that the person that was using my social security number had committed a sex crime. And also in 1983, people started fucking changing. That there was news about the sale of crack, but in the winter of 1983, in the winter of 1983, I had conversations with this police officer on the night shift of Officer Lewis. He told me that an Alvin Howard Shapiro testified in August when I wasn't there, but I made male pornography. I told him, and he said that I made it in June 78. I told him I was in Northeast NASA Psychiatric Center on the grounds of Pilgrim State. And I would continue to say this in certain nights I had spent at that precinct. Certain nights I had spent at that precinct, I would be saying this until I would pass out completely. Then there were other nights we got on other subjects. The thing is that in November 1983, I told Lewis in the winter, but I wasn't going to walk into the I wasn't going to look at male pornography because I like to watch female pornography. And I'm a client to lesbian peep shows, and I'm going to remain that way. In September 1983, I came across a mural on Polk Street, which enabled me to buy a camera and take professional photographs so I could sue like Officer Lewis suggested. In November 1983, I did attempt this lawsuit. I addressed it to a missing carer, Mr. Shapiro, which was the officer's person that he suggested I sue, or who would be within the mural, or whose mural it would be, or who was responsible for the mural, looking like me, but not being me. If you want my opinion, I think it's Ron... Wait! Ron Perio, who was in the TV series... You're not turning it off, are you? Who was in the TV series, Welcome Back, Carter, has heard of this person that just looks like him, and because he probably decided to go to... Probably he decided when the show went off and Travolta became famous, he probably became a porno star or something, or he went to the Navy or deserted the Navy, or the possibility of there's just one thing, the possibility of Colonel Gaddafi making the pornography, or that Perio and Shoemaker is Gaddafi in one, and that he smuggled himself to Lebanon, and I... Thank you.
touch it.
Oh, you see your song?
Yeah. Never any story.
Hi, this is Peter Donalds, host and producer of the Neo Radio Hour. I record the show from my own home studio, if you didn't know, and I don't think I ever told you before. In what otherwise would be a den, I have set up my studio, and while I was recording this week's show, in come my kids. That's Sarah and Jackson. Jack is 2.5, Sarah 6.5. And it reminded me of something I've been meaning to tell you for a long time. Just a little opinion I have. As you might guess, I have a real bias, radio over television, for all the reasons you're probably familiar with. The radio listener is more involved, and the mind is more engaged. For the very same reasons, I've always advocated the use of audio tape to record family memories as opposed to photos or videotape. Photos and videotape are fine, but if you've got an audio recorder, just a little tape deck, use it. Just turn it on, flip it on. Years later, you're going to have a connection like no picture and no videotape can give you. Stranger on the street, you give me this look like you recognize my face, and in my insides I already knew it was true. And that sappy smile that looks like the face of a drunken man says, I know you. You stand up, you point, I'm sickened by that goofy grin. You walk toward me, your mouth open, as if you are about to speak, and you do, and you say to me, I know you. Your hand out to shake, and when you get close and I get a good look, I realize that you may remind me of someone I once knew, but I do not know who. Then we shake, your hand is cold and wet, and I wonder where it's been, and my stomach turns, and then, how are you? Then, how have you been? Then, how are things going? My knees going weak, dizzy and faint, I finally fall to the side, hitting my head, and when I wake up, it is your face I see. About 1 inch from mine, the shock I vomit, you run away laughing while I wrench out my guts, writhing in pain, groaning. I don't know you, I scream, spewing sputum. And I don't.
Demo mode. Put me on demo mode, like my Casio keyboard with a George Winston clone in its memory bank that plays a sweet little tune without me doing anything but press the demo switch. Never mind all that eye twitching, finger freaking, leg beating time in the air, improv, riffing and jiving, holding my own against the infernal drum machine. Somebody pushes the button, and despite my sweat, it's on demo mode. George Winston, or a reasonable facsimile on a memory chip, haunting my keyboard forever, overriding my genius. Going on demo. Wouldn't it be nice when you're too hung over or pissed off or busy daydreaming about your new squeeze? Wouldn't it be nice if you could walk into work and go on demo mode for those special occasions when you just can't handle it? Good morning, Mr. Carruthers. How was your weekend, Gladys? Please take a memo, Gladys. A telephone call? Please put it on hold. Only one thing at a time, in demo mode. Sitting at my computer, agonizing over phrases, chewing over scraps of tormented memories too hot for publication during my lifetime. Too hard work, too lonely, touch of writer's block. Put your word processor on demo mode. At least it will crank out a few pages of copy, even in your absence, establishing some baseline better than zero to measure productivity. Wouldn't it be nice if I could do all my hell-raising, hard-drinking, psychedelic freaking partying in demo mode? In an orderly and unoriginal manner, moderate in all things. I am already burned out on inarticulate groping for the perfect expression, burned out on the adrenaline come-down from bursts of inspiration. The hell with it! Put me on demo! And inoffensive, easy-listening clichés will tumble out of my keys, and I will smile and make nice in the face of impenetrable stupidity and bad taste. Man, put me on demo.
We're penguins, and June 26th. On June 20th, Eric Dolphy would have been 66 years old. And on June 29th is the 30th anniversary of his death. So this is notes for Eric.
So it's Russ and the two girls, say.
Uh-huh.
Do a thing like that, and then just to kind of launch it, you made a small wardrobe change, and so you just jump back into it with, well, it's one for the money, two for the show.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Do that blue suede jeans thing like that.
Uh-huh.
And then I could start going into put the other boy with you. Well, but don't be cruel. Do that to two of you.
Uh-huh.
And I'd like to do Heartbreak Hotel.
Mm-hmm.
And like the hound dog. I might just start bouncing you back and forth there.
Mm-hmm.
And then to get it, to get the thing to end. I hate to use somebody bigger than you and I because I use it in Las Vegas.
Oh.
Okay, of course, I can always find another one of his gospel songs.
Yeah. What's the one, what was the other one you used? You used another gospel song, didn't you?
Another Elvis gospel?
Yeah. No, I guess that's the one. Oh, I know. I was thinking, yeah, you used it in Music Cube. That's right. Yeah, you used the same one. That's what I was thinking of. I was thinking it was a different song.
Well, he's got several of those gospels. I'd love to get a gospel tune in there.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I tell you, a tune you can, a thing you can do is almost an ensemble. Is, you can do that All My Trials thing.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that'd be a weird rock and roll show to do some of that stuff in the trilogy. Battle Hymn of the Republic. Wouldn't it be crazy? He wouldn't be expecting that, I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
I could make that work ensemble.
So as far as this Elvis impression goes, it would be more suggested than really all out, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that.
Like I would used to do it in Music America. I wasn't really trying to do the kid as Elvis. You know, we weren't poking fun at him. We were doing it in honor of, almost.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think this 50 show is complete without him.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah, as long as it's not the full-out costume and really trying to, you know,
do
a full-out.
Oh, no, I don't want him in at all.
Yeah, then,
I'm doing the material.
Yeah.
It's hard to do the material without some of the gestures and things.
Yeah.
Well, of course, what might be crazy is have you two guys flopping back and forth.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I see what I'm getting at. There's a hook on there somewhere that make this work. Look away, Dixieland.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Grandpa might start flowing like a reservoir. My vocal skills to the point isn't over. paralyzed on no chill. Lyrical lunatic who doing shit out of the ordinary microphone. Short nail style, sort of rare for the break. I got the hook so new, you couldn't match it like a duplicate. So chill with that stupid. For this category, it's mandatory that I rip. Even competitors saying, damn, I don't believe it. Fabulous back to you, just call me spectacular. Soon to be pushing a bike legend by Acura. Lay back, counting endless loot for the hell of it. Look, you taking what's mine, now I'm, that's irrelevant and absurd. So I'm, what you heard, say that for the birds, cause you'll get kicked to the curb. I make a new, take a fourth, that's the season. Like boss, I got the recipe, I'm deep for no apparent reason. The battle me is like straight up suicide. For real, I get ill with them skills that I utilize. Monk a freak the funk, does a proper appeal. Shaving niggas in the day, saying, damn, you got skills, kid. I like the others you thought was better. I'm leaving singing over the man like salt and pepper. The big daddy, hello, why? Cause my track keeping cutting wild like some freaking up in Six Flags. That's on the real tip from this blizzard I'm with. It's open, I don't hit their hometown like a blizzard. I get rugged on a mic like Final Fight. It's a kind I ain't quiet up like Solid Night. So prepare for this young boy who's next to rise. So for microphone guys, this is like exercise.
Time for one more call. We've got about 30 seconds here for Lucius on line three. What's on your mind?
Hey, well, I know a little bit about Islam because I used to have a roommate that's, you know, from Lebanon.
Yeah.
And, you know, the difference is if they don't submit, they're going to be killed, like he said. That is true.
That's true.
Hmm.
And in Christianity, you know, if we don't submit, we're going to keep being killed for all eternity in eternal flame. I'd rather be killed once than keep on being killed for all eternity. So I've converted to Islam myself. What do you think? Is that a good idea?
Huh.
What about we discuss?
Hang on the line if you would, please.
Sounds like he's got a pretty good point there,
boy,
fellas.
We've just had so much to talk about tonight, Sam, and
the
hour
Lucius's
has flown by.
Question?
We want to thank our callers tonight, thank our listeners.
I know, there's some logic
hour,
to that, I think.
21. Next
guys?
Week, we will be talking again about Islam. We hope to have Francisco back. And we'll look forward to seeing you guys again soon. Sam?
I don't know. Sounded
it's been
good
a good hour,
me.
Bro.
What do you think,
yeah,
fellas?
Man, it's been good.
It's been good, sure. It's
that,
been good. But what about Lucius' call?
And Lucius, we'll pray for you, brother.
Oh, well, okay. And I want to thank you guys for joining us here at the tail end of the Neo Radio Hour. The Neo Radio Hour is written and produced by Peter Donalds and Frank Skillman. Gee, Lucius had kind of a point there, didn't he? I don't know. Contributing artists tonight, Mike Trina, The Rebels, Intellectual Monarchs, The Bad Magic Poets, organized by M.I. Blue, various poets in San Francisco. Go see them. Stan Sadowski, Annette Dubois, Boris Goldman and Alan Norney, Don Hilla, Kathy Goss, The Penguins, Monk Wittefunk, and Brother Russell. If you would like to contribute your work to the Neo Radio Hour, and we hope that you would, because, you know, everything you hear on the show is produced by folks just like you. Independent writers, artists, musicians. And we like to hear from you. Questions, comments, suggestions, and best of all, you get something on tape, you get it to us. The show is yours. Well, that's about going to do it. Hope to hear from you. Thanks for listening tonight. I hope you taped it. I'm Peter Donalds.